I personally smoked cigarettes for over 20 years. I'm 42 years old now. In 2009, my younger brother, him and I were at a restaurant. We went outside to smoke after we ate like we normally do. And he pulled out a little e-cigarette. And I said, well, what the heck is that? And he goes, try it, man. It's an electronic cigarette. And he's a, you know, tech guy. He's into gadgets and stuff. And I was just like, let me try it. Tried it. Didn't really like it that much, but he kept talking me into it. Anyway, this was back in 2009. I remained a dual user. I still smoked cigarettes, and I smoked the e-cigarettes where I couldn't smoke. Up until 2012, where I bought my first big battery mod. From that day, that was Valentine's Day of 2012, haven't smoked a cigarette since. Now, obviously, we began to be very, you know, involved in the industry with ECC and now with the Vape Exhibit, which is our traveling brand. We've got to see just amazing results from what the vaping product, the vapor product has done for people's lives. Financially, physically, spiritually, people's lives are becoming extremely better because of vaping electronic cigarettes. So when we heard that there was potential looming legislation that was potentially going to either take our products off the market or make them much more difficult to use, everybody in my circle, my personal family, everybody vapes, my business partners all vape, you know, everybody vapes. We just started looking at each other and we're saying, well, what are we going to do? So one of the first things that we did is we started to consult with the industry advocacy groups. ECC has become a SFATA member since, I believe, March 2014. And once we started to really have a bunch of communication with these advocacy organizations, we began to realize just how important it is to also disseminate that message. And so what this meeting is about, the Life After Regulations Conference and Seminar, is an extension of our ongoing effort to provide you, the business owners in this industry, with the information, the education that you'll need in order to not only protect your business, but to have the proper information for you to be able to give to your customers. We've got an exciting lineup here of the industry's top advocates, and in just a minute, we're gonna have Amy McCann from SFATA come up here, but listen to your speakers this afternoon. We have Amy McCann from SFATA, the Smoke-Free Alternative Trade Association, Jay Taylor from the Virginia Smoke-Free Association, we've got Cynthia Cabrera with the Cating Group, Stefan Didak with Not Blowing Smoke, Brittany Cushman, who's a board member of the Vapor Technology Association, and Brian Walters from the Right to Be Smoke-Free organization. And what you're going to be hearing from Brian is some really exciting information about a lawsuit that they're involved with where they're suing the FDA. And again, we are trying to implement every strategy that we can to move this predicate date from February of 2007 up to a more reasonable date so that these products can remain on the market and that your businesses can continue to thrive and we can continue to save lives. So without further ado, I want to introduce to you our first speaker of the morning, Ms. Amy McCann from SFATA. Please give a big round of applause to Amy. Oh, Amy and Nico, I'm being told.
And everyone else.
Round of applause for Nico.
There you go.
Two chairs.
Right. Two chairs, Nico.
Sorry, guys, we're going to sit down so this just is a little more comfortable. And because Mike will tease me if I don't. So I'm Amy, I'm here with SFATA. Everyone here knows what SFATA is, yes?
Yes.
Okay, awesome. This is Nico. Nico's the Maryland chapter president. I'm the Virginia chapter president, the co-president. Oh,
unofficial president.
Unofficial. The unofficial man in charge.
All right, guys, like the gentleman said before me, you know, a lot of shop owners are asking myself and quite a few of others of us, you know, what can the customer do? It's pretty simple for a customer standpoint. Join CASA and tell your story. We all have a story. Myself, but they'll tell their customers. Myself, when I started vaping, I'm sorry. I smoked cigarettes for 11 years and My viewpoint, smoke cigarettes or don't, but you look like a douchebag with that space dildo in your hand. You know, that's the way I viewed it. I gave it a shot and it changed my life. I no longer smoke cigarettes. You know, I own a company. My doctor, he said, I'm not gonna tell you to do this, but your lung improvement is through the roof. You know, this is a healthier alternative than smoking, but I'm not telling you to do it. As far as the regulations, if you don't know that they're arriving on the 8th, they've already arrived. They've been here, we know what they are. You're not gonna be able to let customers sample for free. You're gonna have to charge them a fee. And no, it's not gonna be a penny. It's not gonna be 10 cents. There's some talks about being able to charge for a membership fee, but that has to be nominal as well.
And if you're gonna do a membership club, you need to be able to track it. You need to track every sample they have, the fee, IDing the person, making sure it's the same person. So the biggest initial thing is gonna be IDing everyone under the age of 27. Also, if you're in the state of Virginia, the current law already is you need to have a sign in your shop stating that you have to be 18 to purchase. Everyone make sure they have that. That'll be the first thing for compliance that they're looking for. So make sure you have those in your shops. For online sales, the click yes, I'm over 18 isn't gonna cut it. You need to have a third party verification system. Cynthia can direct you to some. Just don't be dumb. You know, you guys know if you're carding someone or not. Card everyone that looks like they're under 30. Don't play around with it. Nico said you've got to charge a fee. No leave a penny, take a penny jars. You can't discount back the amount that they paid to sample. You can't discount back that dollar sampling fee. That's you giving it to them for free. For August 8th is the beginning of the compliance period, especially for manufacturers, okay? So if you're building a coil in your shop, you're a manufacturer. If you cannot exactly replicate that coil, including like its output, the exact cotton, the exact wire from the exact wire manufacturer, the exact addy you're installing it on, if you can't verify that and you don't have evidence of you doing that, you can no longer do it. Basically, just don't do it. Building coils, buy them from a third party that's gonna register as a manufacturer that has some kind of process. There's too much human error in it. So there's no reason to put ourselves at risk. And the time period between August 8th and what, December 31st, it's not a loophole time frame. That's not the, I think Cynthia, it's not the don't be cute phase. It is the don't be cute phase. Like, you can't just say, oh, I'm gonna do it and then I just won't register in December. That's not what it means. You have to stop doing it on the 8th. Yep. Same materials. If you look up for how your product has been, give me a word. You need to, for evidence of how your product has been on the market, right? So you have to show that you've had the same exact processes, your GMPs, same ingredients, same everything. You have to show that it has been available to the public, that it's been sold. You can't just say, oh, I made this recipe 5 years ago, here's a computer file of it. That's not gonna be enough. You have to have some real solid documentation.
All right, so in terms of, you know, CASA is for consumers. Safada, Virginia Smoke Free, that is for us, business owners. If you profit in this industry, you can join a trade association. You need to join a trade association. Whether that be you're a juice manufacturer, a distributor, a shop owner, we have embroidery companies. If you profit from this industry, you need to join. You need to help the fight, or at least you want to.
Help the fight and have access to good information. Don't depend on Facebook to be your lawyer. You want a real lawyer. You don't want Facebook. You want to be able to be on calls and on in webinars and at fly-ins. You want to be meeting with the real lawyers. You want to be meeting with the legislators. You want to be meeting with the people that are making these decisions for us and the people that can best go through the muddy waters of the demon regulations. We're not, you know, lawyers. A few of us probably are, but, you know, for the most part, I mean, we're business owners. That's not our thing. So pay up, join an association that can give you accurate information. If you depend on Facebook or you depend on, you know, other people that are paying for the lawyers, you're liable to not get the best information possible. Like me, I give free advice all the time. Ask the Hampton Roads guys, they know. I love to give them my free advice. They love it. But they're not paying for it, so it's sometimes, you know, just more questions, more questions, more questions. You guys, you gotta pay up for it, you know? It's not, no one's making a profit off of it. No one's, I mean, except Stefan, he's got a private jet. But like, no one's making any money.
With a stripper pole.
You know, no one's making any money. We're paying for lawyers, we're paying for action. And you guys just gotta help. You know, you want to help. It's better for you, it's better for your business, it's better for the industry as a whole. And that can lead right into Jay. Everybody know Jay Taylor from Virginia Smoke Free. I'm also a member of Virginia Smoke Free. We do have a Virginia Safada chapter, but there's also the Virginia Smoke Free Association. There are two options in Virginia to be in a trade association. So there is no excuse for anyone to not be in one. VSFA has worked hard this year. They've worked hard in Richmond. They've got a few bills pushed back. Jay has done a great job, so here is he.
Well, thanks, Amy. And like Amy was saying a little while ago, Amy, how many questions have you been getting from people who aren't part of a trade association? All these flood of last-minute questions, what's going to happen?
4,065.
Right. And we have the VSFA, we have 25 members now, and those 25 members are the ones who are going to get our attention, you know. But that's the importance here in Virginia. A little bit about my story, I guess I kind of start on that a little bit. I used to work right across the street at the United Network for Organ Sharing, helping save lives through organ transplantation, smoking three packs of Marlboro Reds a day. And then once I found vaping, it became my calling to help save as many people's lives or potentially help somebody not need an organ transplant because they didn't damage their body that bad. And that's when I chunked my 12-year career with them and opened my business, and it's been wonderful ever since until now. But here in Virginia, we formed last year, last July, and we were able to build up enough members that we were able to secure Steve Burrell as our lobbyist, and he will be here as part of the panel tomorrow. And working with Steve, we did a lot of relationship building. We got to play the game on their turf by their rules. So Steve was able to represent us at several high visibility functions and get our name out there. He also set up a day on the Hill for us where Amy went and myself, and is Mike in the room? I'm not sure if Mike's here or not. Anyway, Mike from Vape Motive went with us. And we met with 11 different either senators or delegates and up on the Hill that day. And it was just impressive to see how he was able to get those lined up for us. And within a 4-hour window, we met with those people. And they were genuinely, I was really surprised, Amy, I don't know if you were, of how many of them actually were aware of what was going on and had staffers or staffers' children or whatever that got off smoking and vaping.
Yeah, I mean, Virginia, we already know that we're tobacco country. We are also vaping country now. And we have legislators that are involved in the vaping industry through retail leasing. So they know a lot and they're really open to listening. But we need more people to bring to the meetings that are in their districts so that when we go in, we can actually say, you know, hey, we're your voters. You know, this is this. If I'm in a different district, they don't care what I say in their office. They want to get reelected. So we need to be in there as constituents, which is why we need as many shops as possible to be involved in your state trade associations.
That's exactly right. These people, when we go sit down and talk with them, we need to show them that we represent this many businesses in your district, which represents this many thousands or hundreds of thousands of square feet of retail rental space. It represents 500 employees that are in your district. You know, it represents this much in sales tax that we're paying to the state. That's what they understand. And
and we sent out all the Virginia shop owners like a simple like Survey Monkey anonymous, and I'm sorry to call everybody out, but y'all can't, not y'all, not everyone obviously, but a great majority of y'all couldn't even fill out the freaking survey. I'm not asking for personal information, I'm not asking for your name, we're asking for like square footage, number of employees. This is the stuff that we're up against. We need your help to make this work. If you can't do these little tiny things to help us, we're not asking you to give us all your money, we're not asking you to do all the legwork, we're just asking you to help supply us with simple information.
Yep. That way we walk in with educated numbers, real numbers that mean something to the people. But so you know, this year in Virginia, we had three bills that came up. One would have put a 15% wholesale tax across the board on vaping industry here in Virginia. The second one would have amended the Virginia Indoor Clean Air Act to include vaping as smoking. And the third one, we really weren't up, didn't really speak against. It was a bill that that would have mandated that all public school systems create a rule saying there's no vaping on school property, no vaping on school buses, or school-sponsored events. Well, that we were okay with that, but except for the last part, it upset some people because they're like, well, what if this is at a facility that does not belong to a school school board, and they want that it's okay to vape there. So that that bill got killed on its own. The other two, we were able to get the 15% wholesale tax one withdrawn before it even got a vote. And then the second one, the Indoor Act one, we got killed and it died in committee. And so two of those three right there would have heavily impacted. Two of those three bills could have heavily impacted the vaping industry here in Virginia. And you had 25 members that supported the lobbyists who handled that. How many vape shops, how many, yep.
It's about people and numbers, then why is the amount of money so high to be a part of it? Because I know that I am barely surviving in my vape shop. I want to be a part of an association. I'm obviously in the fight, I've been in the fight for a long time, but the money is so much, $3,000, $3,500 if you do this, whatever it may be.
Safada is as little as $250 a year. VSF, yeah, no, and how do I put this nicely? And VSFA in particular, if you call Jay, they'll work with you. They will work with you.
Yeah, ours is based off of volume, and to make it, ours is based off volume to make it as fair for everybody. Because it takes money to hire lobby, and our books are transparent. You know, they're all of our members can access them. We put a quarterly one up on our website.
Excuse me one moment, and I do appreciate the question. Unfortunately, not everybody else can hear, so we are going to ask that all questions be held until after. Let's let the presenters go through their presentations. There will be questions, time for question and answers after this, okay? Thank you so much.
And please feel free to stop by and see me. I'll be right at the booth, and I'll be happy to talk to you about it. But so that's what we achieved here this year. What's the future look like? Well, all we have to do is look towards Pennsylvania, DC, all these other states, and now we are classified as a tobacco product. Last year we were not. So we pretty much anticipate the majority of things that came out last year and additional to come back this year. And the more bills we have to fight, the more it costs and the more members we need. And so that's, we're touching on part of that. We'll talk about it more later. But so here in Virginia, we have a very good lobbyist. He was rock solid, and he will be here tomorrow, and he'll be able to help answer some of your questions too, as well as far as why is it so important. Yeah, this year, right. Last year we started off at one membership rate. This year, because we've got more members, we were able to reduce it, and we're continuously doing that. We also have different ways of where people can make payment schedules. We can have people, some people donate and be an associate member. In other words, you wouldn't get a vote on the, a vote, but you'd be able to donate towards the cause. So we have all different kinds of options. Okay, let's see. But we're going to be over, I think they're going to move us. They had some layout issues that they're straightening out, but we should be right up front. Please feel free to drop by to find out, ask any questions, find out what we're looking at and everything for this upcoming year. Who's next? Cynthia. Woohoo. Uh-oh, here you go.
Hey, everybody. I'm Cynthia Cabrera. So I've been doing this, I've been working in the vapor industry for 5 years, since 2011. I worked for an e-cig company for about a year and a half. Then I worked at Safada. I built up Safada for 3.5 years. And now I work for a consulting company, also in the vapor space, doing the work that I love. Because this is a great industry, right? We love this. This is where you make your money. This is your business, right? So, all the presenters are talking about different things. I'm gonna talk a little bit about your business. The business that you love, the business that I love, and that we hope we can save, right? It's a whole industry, we're not saving one person. Either we all fight together or everybody goes down together. So. Okay, so right now we're looking at a situation where the first thing as a business that you need to do is to make sure that you're compliant. And because I addressed this question yesterday, I'm going to address it now. So when you register with the FDA, and I'm just talking about general compliance stuff, when you register with the FDA in December, as part of a marketing strategy, you cannot say that you are FDA compliant, that you're an FDA registered facility. All that you've done is comply with the rule that you have to register with them in order to stay in the industry. Because I've already got people telling me how they're changing up their labels and they're gonna show that they're FDA registered and they're a registered facility, and that's not what it means. So be very careful, because whereas before, the scrutiny that was on the industry was not based in a regulatory structure, it is now. So, well, it will be as of Monday. So you have to be very careful with that stuff. Also, the FDA has not issued GMPs. They have not issued product standards. So be very careful going forward how you explain what to your customers and to people you sell to, what you are and what you are not. What you've done is register with the FDA, but you can't possibly be GMP compliant because they haven't given GMPs yet. They don't even call it GMP. Thank you. So these are all things, and the reason that I bring it up, they're little things, but I bring it up because there will be increased scrutiny. I don't know if you guys were listening to the last FDA phone call, but webinar that they did, but they were talking about how they're gonna be hiring tons more people so that they can work on enforcement. Whereas before they were backlogged and they didn't have enough people, now they're just gonna be hiring reams and reams of people so that they can enforce all this stuff.
And collect fines.
So if you think that you're gonna slip under the radar because FDA can't possibly catch up to you, well, do you wanna take the risk and be the one? that they do catch up to. So it's easy enough not to do, just don't do it. I mean, just do what you're supposed to do. Age verification, remember that? The other thing is, to be clear, again, August 8th, which is Monday, August 8th does not mean that these products are grandfathered. It means they're not grandfathered, but we were given a reprieve of 2 or 3 years to work on it. But they're not grandfathered. It doesn't mean that the products that are on the market today will stay on the market past 2 or 3 years. There's a lot of stuff that goes into it, and other people will talk about that, I think. But so be very clear, the products are not grandfathered in. They're only on the market for the next 2 or 3 years unless something changes. But we're gonna talk about that too. Age verification, make sure you do your age verification online and in store. Online, it's not enough that they click a box that says that they're 18 or older. You should have something on the landing page, you should have something at checkout, and you should be using a third-party age verifying system that's not you, third party, somebody else that gives you the service. And if you need a recommendation, I can give you one. But even though we have this big like hammer of doom hanging over our heads, right? You still have to do business, right? You still have to conduct business. You still want to grow, some of you. Some of you might be planning your exit strategy. I'm sure everybody has an exit strategy for something. You might be planning your exit strategy that at the end of 2 years, you're just gonna close it up and move on to something else and, you know, take the money you banked and retire in Tahiti or something. And people have told me that they're gonna wait it out and then they're gonna shut it down. But other people are not planning on doing that. So for the people that are not planning on doing that, you wanna make really sure that the people, the vendors, the suppliers that you do business with from now forward are compliant. That you ask them what they're doing, can they give you proof, what are their plans for the future, to stay in business. If your plan is to stay in business in the long term, and all of that of course depends on what your business plan is and what your resources are and all that, but the people that you do business with, you wanna make sure that you start partnering up with people that have a similar vision and goal that you do. Because it doesn't make sense to get into a long-term deal with somebody when they're secretly, or they just haven't mentioned to you, that they're planning on bailing out after 2 years. And if they're not planning on bailing out, then it's totally legit to ask them what their plans are. They're not giving you the secret sauce, they're just telling you what their plans are so that you can make your plans. If you have not started doing it yet, I can't even tell you enough. Everybody here should have customer lists of all, if you're a retailer, you should have a list of all the consumers you sell to. Not because you need it for FDA, but because you're gonna need it for other stuff. So if you're selling and you're not capturing your customers' data, you absolutely have to start doing that. You're gonna be called on to use that data and it's gonna be needed by the industry. And if you don't have it, you really didn't do your part, not for the industry and not for yourselves, not for your business. You need that. You need that information. Marketing strategies. Oh, by the way, before I go to marketing strategies, you also should have, by now, I mean it's Friday, Monday is the deadline, all the products that you have commercially available, you should have documentation, you should have proof that all those things, you don't have to provide it to anybody, you just have to have it and be able to prove it. Everybody in here should have a dated inventory list. Everybody in here should have invoices that reflect purchase order, that support the purchase orders and the delivery orders that were made, that matches what's in the inventory. Everybody should have that by now. And these are just examples of some of the things that you can use to prove that your products were on the market. This, by the way, is only required if you're the manufacturer. If you're a retailer, you don't have to prove it was on the market. It's the manufacturer. Marketing. You gotta clean, not you, whoever. The royal you, like the royal we up here. The royal you, the royal we is telling the royal you that the cartoons and the, so to make it clear, marketing that I don't think anybody in this room markets to minors. I don't think anybody does that. Designed originally to appeal to minors. And then they adapted it for their own purposes, which is the adult market. But it doesn't change the fact that the font and the colors and the styling and all of that was originally designed to appeal to youth. My point in this is, they're gonna be looking at, if you think it was bad before, now there's actual enforcement. Now they actually can come after you, and there's fines, and there's cease and desist letters, and there's jail time?
30.
At the end?
Yeah.
You gotta, yeah, you have to, since the, you're just, I'm dying to say the F word. We had a joke about who was gonna drop the F bomb first, and nobody hit.
What did you say?
He said douchebag.
He said douchebag. It's not the same as the F bomb.
Don't be fucking irresponsible.
If you keep fucking it up, they will find you. I got it out. Okay. So this is your opportunity. I mean, listen, the deadline is Monday, so any major changes you were going to make to your labels and all that other stuff should be done. By the way, I also want to reinforce the registrations that you do in December, December 31st, at the end of this year, also include your labels. It's not just listing the name of the product. If there's a label, it includes the labels. That's required. Yeah, terrified me. Okay. So marketing strategies, etc. Okay, but there are still opportunities there. There are opportunities to join forces with other companies. There are opportunities to acquire other companies. There are opportunities to kind of blend your organization into something you wanted it to be before. Yeah, this is a really crappy time, but there's opportunity in crappy times. And smart people are already looking at building alliances and trying to share the burden of trying to get through this together. And there's a lot of different ways to do that, but just know that they're available to you. Just because the regs are coming out or becoming effective doesn't mean that you don't have business opportunities that you can take advantage of. There's a lot of new products that were introduced into the market prior to this date that have yet to be discovered by, you know, the mass of the vapor industry. I remember, there's still a whole, you know, 40 million people smoking cigarettes that need marketing to. The vapor people are sold. Let's go get the smokers,
yeah.
Right?
Yep.
Yay.
It's the little wins.
I will tell you, and I rarely ever tell this story, but I told it the other day, and so, I don't know. I guess maybe I'm getting comfortable telling the story. So my father died of throat cancer. He died a really, really horrible death. The same year that my brother died, my father died, and he suffered a lot. It was just ugly. And the thing is, I don't even do this because of that. I do this because I support and believe in everybody's right to use a product that's better for them. And I think that's your right, and I'm gonna fight for that right as long as you wanna fight for that right. So, now I'm gonna bring you down, give you a little peppy, and now I'm gonna bring you down. Remember that the FDA, you're doing all these plans, you're making all these moves, but the FDA reserves the right to issue additional guidance, issue additional changes, issue additional curveballs that you didn't see coming, but they have every right currently to do. So why do I tell you this? So that you don't lose your minds. Everybody's running around, not everybody, but a lot of people are running around with the, you know, chicken without the head thing or whatever. Guys, we've been talking about this for 5 years, since 2011. I've known about this, I've been talking about this. I know everybody here on the stage, the royal we here, has been talking about it. It's not new, and there's more hits coming, so the thing is to not lose our minds, keep making good business decisions, and keep moving forward. Keep saying which really aggravates me. Okay, now, all of these business things that you can do, the compliance, and by the way, I have, you know, all the, if we have Q&A later, Brittany has a list, I have a list, I'm sure other people have a list. If you have questions about what compliance dates are and what's due when and all that, we can answer those questions for you. But none of the business strategies that you employ, none of the things that you do, let me ask, show of hands, who's in this for the long haul? Okay, so if you're in this for the long haul, it's not just about business and it's not just about letting other people do it and it's not just about hoping for the best. None of the business decisions that you make, none of those efforts are worth it without also supporting legislative strategies. And I'm gonna hand it over to Brittany, she's gonna talk about that. There's not always just one thing you can do, there are multiple things you can do. I gotta tell you guys, we have to spend less time arguing about who's right and more time doing something to move the ball forward. We don't have any time to waste. The rubber hit the road, right? Hit the road in first week of May. We're all screwed if everybody doesn't start pulling in the right direction. I'm not with Safad anymore, but I'm doing work with state groups and on national work and all that to, again, keep moving the ball forward. If we don't do this, we're all gonna go down together. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Brittany so she can talk about legislative options. And
I want to introduce Brittany if I can. One of the things I forgot to mention that was on my notes here is one of the things the Virginia Smoke Free Association recently did was we joined the Vapor Technology Association. So not only as a member do you have state representation, but you have national representation as well. And with that, I will turn it over to Brittany.
Hi, I'm Brittany Cushman. As Jay was saying, I'm with the Vapor Technology Association. I tell you very brief story about VTA for those who aren't familiar with it. We kind of started around late last year, really kicked off the beginning of this year, and we're made up of retailers, distributors, wholesalers, importers, suppliers, flavor houses. Our mission is to keep the vapor market open for as long as possible and provide consumer choice as broadly as possible. And that is what we try to do every day and what we spend an inordinate amount of unpaid time doing. And so me personally, for those who don't know me, and I know there are a lot in the room who don't, I have been dealing with the very lovely FDA since 2010, well really June of 2009 when they first signed the Tobacco Control Act into law, and I've been following the vapor market or in the vapor market since that time as well. I have submitted documents to the FDA, I've met with the FDA, I've done all these terrible online registrations for them where they lose your data and then they find it and then it's wrong. They come into your facility and they tell you it's wrong and you say, no, here it is, it's actually right. So they're kind of a disaster and, you know, we're ready to deal with that. But just know that they don't have all the answers, they don't pretend to have all the answers, but they expect you to have all the answers. And so that's where it becomes very important to align yourselves with trade associations and with people who know what's going on, because you can't do this on your own and you need help. So very quickly, I'm going to go through number one, an overview of what happens on Monday. Number two, what's going on legislatively, and then I'll very briefly touch on litigation, but I know that that's going to be covered in more detail later by Brian. So, number one, what do you expect on Monday, August 8th? I thought Cynthia was going to hand it over to me with her hammer of doom comment, but you know, nicely she did not hand it over in that manner. But so on August 8th, what happens is the quote unquote market freeze. So you can no longer make changes to your products. You can't put out new products without a marketing order from the FDA. And I don't think anyone's ready to file any substantial equivalents or pre-market tobacco applications day one to get that approval. And even if you did, it's gonna sit at the FDA for many months or years. Also on August 8th, as we've discussed, you have to start doing government-issued ID checks, whether it be online or in store. The FDA did make clear when they issued the regulation they did not intend to ban online sales when they started requiring the government-issued ID check. Sampling is also banned, which has been discussed. There are a lot of nuances to the sampling, and people are looking at, you know, well, how can I continue to allow my consumers to try out products? you know, why would a smoker switch over if they can't even try this out and see if they like it? So there are some ways of dealing with that. As discussed, you know, a penny probably isn't going to work. Developing, you know, you pay $10 one time and that covers you for life, that's probably not going to work either, because what they're looking for is that there is a transaction that happens between the consumer and the retailer, and there has to be money that exchanges hands, and it probably should pass the laugh test. So you're probably not, you know, giving something away for a penny. There's a cost to it, so you got to look at, if you're in a state that's taxed, you know, are you covering that tax? You know, what's the cost of the product? That's generally some,
what was that?
And tasting is a sample. The FDA looks at it is, has something been consumed? So are you consuming battery usage? Are you consuming actual liquid? Is something, you know, a transaction taking place without money? Things that have come up in the past under the sampling rule that I can clarify for you, it does not limit your ability to coupon so long as the coupon isn't for a free product. It does not limit buy one, get one free so long as it's you're coupling two regulated, you know, quote unquote tobacco products. So you can say, you know, buy a 30 milliliter bottle, get a 10 milliliter bottle free. Buy a 10 milliliter, get a 10 milliliter for free. That's still allowed. You can also do loyalty programs. There's been a federal lawsuit over this in the tobacco context, and you know, if you buy 10 bottles, you can give away that next one for free. And that's the current case law. I would encourage you that if you have a very specific question about that, that you join up in a trade association, because at the base of it, it's crowdsourced legal funding or crowdsourced legal advice. And I can tell you, you don't want to be paying FDA attorneys on your own, you know, $600+ per hour to give you these answers. And that's, you know, the minimum rate you're going to find for someone who actually knows what they're talking about. Let's see. So what doesn't happen? That's, you know, a question that people often don't ask. What doesn't happen on Monday? Flavors are not banned on Monday. Flavored products in any context are not banned on Monday. Self-service displays are not banned. That doesn't mean the FDA won't come back and later say it's banned, either under a regulation or a guidance of some sort, but right now it's not banned. Products that are on the market as of Monday are not banned. After that date, as we discussed, it's a market freeze. And also, as I discussed previously, internet sales are not banned either, so long as you're doing the government-issued ID checks. So generally, what does it mean to be a regulated entity? So some of this applies more so if you're manufacturing. So number one, what does it mean to be a manufacturer? Well, under the FDA, they define manufacturing as one who repacks, relabels, fabricates, assembles, processes, etc. So you're getting a big bulk thing of liquid in. If you bottle that and put your label on it, you're a manufacturer. You know, that sucks, but that's how it is. And so what does that mean? On December 31st, you have to file as a manufacturer, you have to submit a product list. So they know what your products are. If they come in and they say, oh, hey, you've got this you know, blue raspberry product, this wasn't on your list. You know, that's going to be a misbranded product then. And that's what they term it as, misbranded product, if it's, you know, a product that's out there without being registered. In February, you'll have to submit a list of ingredients or a list of components that make up your final product. They're also regulating components and parts, which they don't differentiate. And what that means is it's a product that's intended to be used with a tobacco product. So that's where they get you on devices, even though the devices don't have nicotine or tobacco-derived nicotine in them. Yeah, if you're a small-scale manufacturer, which is defined in the law, so you make under $5 million and have, what was it, 150 employees, then you get an extra 6 months to do the ingredient listing, so it kicks it back to August. So other things this means, ban on certain descriptors, so you can't use the terms light, mild, low. You can choose at the end of 2 years, so August 8th of 2018, you can choose to submit a pre-market tobacco application, which, as you've heard, is a big, scary endeavor that, you know, I'm not quite convinced anyone is able to do given the guidance the FDA has put out. And when I say anyone, I truly mean anyone from the Philip Morrises of the world on down. I think the way they put it out there, I don't know how it can be done. And that is my nice hammer of doom segue into what I think is the more uplifting part of the discussion, which is, what can we do? What are we trying to do to affect these regulations? So at the outset, I will say it is very important that all of these things happen in parallel. You don't just get to choose, oh, well, I'm supporting litigation and I'm gonna bank on that. I can't do litigation, but I'm gonna support legislation. You can't just do that. You gotta do it all in tandem. So the first thing is legislation, and that's kind of my sweet spot. I love politics. I have the TV on all day, and you know, I'm listening to podcasts all day. But the presidential politics isn't what's important here. What is important is our legislation. So I've been very heavily involved in the appropriations process, which you may or may not have heard about. And what that means is we brought some language in that would move the grandfather date from back in February 15, 2007 up to the effective date of the regulation Monday, so that all the products that are currently on the market can stay on the market without having to file these very expensive applications. And what's also important is that anything on the market can be used as a predicate product so that you can continue to innovate going forward. And that's a very important point, because a substantial equivalence application, although still daunting, is doable. And people have done it. I know companies that have done it. Your friend at the Baileys have done it. And it's hard, but it can be done, and people know how to do it. FDA attorneys can walk you through that process. The PMTA process, you know, I think Swedish Match got through because the FDA had to say, well, somebody got through. What they don't tell you is they were trying to go through substantial equivalence and were about to get denied, and they withdrew their application and put it in as a PMTA. So the cost estimate, the FDA would tell you that it is around $350,000. I would say it is at a bare minimum, depending on what kind of component or part you're talking about, a million plus. I think it could be as high as 10 to 12 million per application, depending on how the FDA interprets things. And I've actually done just a piece of the toxicological requirement that they put in their guidance to just kind of game out, if you got a really good deal at a lab, what that would look like for a product, and it's not pretty. So that's, you know, not only is it an expense, it's a time crunch, and that's why I think one of the reasons even large companies will have a problem with this is you can't do some of this in 2 years. You can't go meet with the FDA, give them 45 days notice to set up a meeting, and then go out and do a study and have it interpreted within a 2 year period. So, that's why this portion of the discussion is so important. So, I digress, back to the legislation. So, at the appropriations process, which began earlier this year, we offered this language that would change the date. It was offered at full committee, so it was brought forth. The proponents of the language, which were Tom Cole and Sanford Bishop, so it was a bipartisan amendment, which is very important because last year it was heavily Republican supported. This year we had to get a bipartisan support. So Congressman Bishop was kind enough to work with his constituents, listen to them, and really understand this, and really go out on a limb as, you know, one of the first major Democratic proponents of this language. So they went on the floor of the committee, discussed it, got hammered on by some of the Democrats in the room, including the now very unpopular Debbie Wasserman Schultz. And there was a vote at the end. We had a very strong vote. We had a bipartisan vote. Congressman Cuellar out of Texas also voted in favor of the language, and it moved through the process. It is baked into the appropriations bill now. And as we know, Congress doesn't always function in the way the cartoon How a Bill Becomes a Law taught us when we were young. So for a fun fact, you might hear someone say, oh, well, you know, it's still got to go to the floor and go to the Senate and go through those committees and then be voted on the Senate floor, and then it goes to the president. In reality, that hasn't happened since 1994. So don't hold your breath that that process is happening this year. What happens in reality is you get something called a continuing resolution sometime around September 30th at midnight to keep the government from shutting down on October 1st because none of the appropriations bills have been passed. And that's what we're headed toward this time because Congress isn't even coming back until the beginning of September. And from there, we determine how long the government will be funded without coming up with some kind of appropriations deal. So let's say the continuing resolution goes to December. Well, around that time, all the leadership of both the Democrats and the Republicans in the House and Senate will get together and they'll start horse trading and they'll say, what provisions are important to us? What provisions do we not like? And that's where you all come in. You have to tell your federal delegation, this is important to us and this will shut us down, and this is important to us personally because we use these products, this is important to us because our mother or our father uses these products, and this is important because a whole host of people in this country are quitting smoking on these products. You can't get rid of them. You can't allow the FDA to take them away. That's where your voice becomes incredibly important, and there are many, many ways for your voice to be heard. Some of the ways your voice can be heard are either through setting up in-district meetings with your federal leaders, and the trade associations out there can help you do that and give you the talking points and help you tell your story in the most effective way possible. You can also do a lot of grassroots work, which is what some of the groups up here are doing. The VTA has put together with our public affairs people a campaign called We Are Vapor. So you might see hashtag We Are Vapor starting up. We just kind of slowly started rolling it out in the past week or so. And what we're asking is that people go out, take a picture in front of their shop with their employees or with some of their consumers and say, hey, you know, we're real people out here. We're your constituents. We're businesses. You know, we're not just some abstract idea out there. And we're having you tag your federal leaders because they've got staff that follow their Twitter feeds and follow their Facebook feeds, and they're gonna print those out or they're gonna take down notes and say, hey, we got 100 people today tagging us on this issue. We need to look into it more. And then when you go in and talk to them, they're gonna already have looked at it and know that people care about it. So it all really works hand in hand. So when you see people out there asking you to do these things, it's not just a fun, cute little social media thing. It's really helping move the needle with your federal representatives. Try to wrap up here. I'm sure I'm talking over at this point. Hey now. So I will skip over my litigation talk, but know that it goes hand in hand with everything else. But just know that it happens hand in hand and you can't just support one or the other. It's gotta be everything all at once.
Brittany, you had one job today, and that was to depress everybody here. You actually haven't depressed everybody as much as we hoped, so I'm gonna help you just a little. So guess what? This part of VPX was called Life After Regulations. Guess what, I've got news for you. There's no such thing as after regulations. It's life during regulations, because they're not gonna go away. Is that depressing enough? Anyway, hi, I'm Stefan Dudek. I'm the founder and president of Not Blowing Smoke. Who here is aware of Not Blowing Smoke? Yeah, I figured. So I'm gonna like skip over the history part where we started like a year ago as basically a very rebellious middle finger to the California Department of Public Health putting out a $7 million smear campaign and how it got derailed. I mean, you all know that, right? Well, guess what? A year into this, we're growing up. We realized that, well, I'm not growing up. I mean, the organization is growing up. I'm not gonna be adulting. I mean, come on. I'm in the vapor space. Why should I be adulting at any point, right? So the organization's growing up, and the number of people you can reach through social media is limited. I mean, best possible reach for vapors that you could hope for is about 300,000 to 400,000. There's 9 million vapors out there. They're not active online. They're your customers. They go to your store, they buy their liquid, they go home, they vape, they live their lives. These folks are usually not aware of what's going on, either at the state level, they don't know about regulations, they hear stuff, and you know what? Every now and then I go into a retail store pretty much incognito, as much as I can, and I talk to the average vapor, and I always hear the same thing. Oh yeah, I read that in the paper, but they're not gonna do that. No, they can't do that. Well, guess what? Yes, they can, and they have, and they do. I mean, look at several states, look at Pennsylvania. 40% tax, 40% floor tax. You got 100 grand sitting on your shelves, now you have to cut them a check for $40,000. It's a lot more expensive than joining a trade association, absolutely. So how do we reach those people? How do we get the average vapor to become active? That's where you come in, because they're your customers, you talk to them. And what we've been hearing for a very long time is, I don't know what to tell them. I don't have anything. So go to fdaregs.info, go to Not Blowing Smoke, go to nomorecasualties.org. We have print material for you there. Unfortunately, we cannot print it and send it out because we just don't have the funding to do that in a mass scale. But use some of your marketing budget. Print out 200 flyers, have them in your store, hand them to your customers. Because we need an army of 9 million vapers. Think about what a voting bloc that would be, right? And politicians care about votes. They care about being reelected. Social media is great. We own social media. We can have massive reach, but it's not enough. So as part of growing up, a month ago, Not Blowing Smoke cut a really, really massive check, and we bought into a year-long of PR services. And we're offering those services to other state groups because guess what? We can go into the system and say, get me all the journalists who wrote for papers, newspapers specifically, and who wrote about tobacco positively within the past 6 months. And they have to be in this location, in a radius of whatever. And it gets you all the contact details, their phone numbers, their email addresses, their history, who they worked for, what they've written. That allows us to reach out to the mainstream media because guess what? The battle is out there. You've all seen the nasty stories for the past several years, right? Are you sick and tired of those?
Yeah.
It's time we start putting positive stories in the media. Unfortunately, that normally requires hiring the services of PR agencies, and PR agencies are expensive. Really expensive. So what we can do now is focus on what's going on in your state or focus on a legislative issue. Take a really heartfelt story of a vapor, because you know what? Vapors have really great stories. Most stories are sort of the same. I quit smoking. That's great. But we need a little more. We need something that pulls on the heartstrings, because media is not interested in you as business owners losing your business. They're not interested in job loss. They're not interested in the economic message. They're interested in stories. So let's give them stories. And while we give them those stories, hook in the issue that is going on in your state. For example, in California, we're facing a ballot measure. They want to tax vapor products 62 to 69% on wholesale. It's on the ballot. We need 9 million votes just to swing the needle to a no vote. That's a lot of votes, and guess what? There's not enough vapors in California to do that. So we need the vapors, we need their family, we need their friends, and we need a whole slice of the general population to vote no, right? So putting those stories out and hooking in, oh well, blah blah blah, such and so, here's a story, and boy, look at what they're trying to do. They're trying to tax this and make it more expensive than smoking. You get the message out, you get it in the mainstream, and at the same time, you get positive vapor news because they're reporting on a story. And for the local state associations here, if there's anything going on in your state, you need PR support and help, you talk to me, we'll help you. So yeah, we're growing up, except not me. Maybe next year. Oh, yeah, and that's true. The jokes about the private jet that Not Blowing Smoke reportedly owns, with the stripper pole and the all-you-can-drink bar, it doesn't actually exist, but maybe next year.
What?
It's actually a yacht.
Oh, yes. Cynthia, thank you very much for your generous donation. Cynthia just gave us a yacht because I don't have a private jet. Yay. Thank you, Cynthia. Anyway, I'm going to introduce the gentleman all the way at the end here. And I think I'm going to just introduce you as my brother from another mother, Brian.
Thank you. You guys mind if I walk? It's all very poetic, isn't it? We're in Virginia 2 days before August 8th. Think about that. We are in the belly of the beast right before shit gets real. But we're all alive, right? Y'all have air in your lungs. Won't everyone take a big deep breath with me, because I'm about to hand you kind of what everyone deserves right now. Ready? One, two, deep breath in. We did this to ourselves. We absolutely did this to ourselves. In the last month alone, I watched every one of you cannibalize the margins out of your pockets. The rush to 60s. The rush to $18.60s. Are those companies gonna stick around for PMTA? Is that product gonna still be on the market? But y'all just robbed yourself. I wanna come over here for a second. What were you saying a moment ago? When last year everything was getting said about the associations. You wanted to give money, but you didn't know where the money was going, did you?
I've been a part of the fight, ever since 10 years ago when I was at a kiosk and I believed it, So I've always been a part of the fight. Even that just started 3 years ago, kind of pissed me off because I've been a part of 15 years ago. I sold plenty of my truck and cigarettes. But I know I'm looking at it like I'm not part of the fight.
Oh no, I can feel you're part of the fight.
But I've got money to offer, but I don't have $3,000 today. I don't have $3,500.
Thank you. This past week on Not Blowing Smoke, I made a post that started, it caught on fire pretty fast. Pretty much saying, I was really sick of seeing the people chiming in 4 days before August 8th and asking questions. Because they're not part of an association that could have told them, because maybe they weren't part of the association, again, there because of monies.
And I also felt bad about asking questions because I wasn't part of the association.
Cool, man. Catch up with me after this. But the reason I brought it up, one of the things that I said kind of caught some attention. I said, if you're not part of an association, in just cold hard fact, you got to pay your dues somehow. This led into a ton of responses. And the responses pretty much were all along the same. Do you know in the state of Ohio, there's two state FSAs? That's nuts. You're cannibalizing your own state with associations. That's been this industry all along, hasn't it? Someone comes up with an idea, I'm gonna get another one. So there's people that didn't even know where to put their money. Right now, these people on stage, as well as many others, have really been fighting for such a long time to get to a point where we're in front of a judge in Washington, D.C., and that is on October 19th. The Right to Be Smoke-Free Coalition started from a conversation with Rob Crossey and I back last June. If you didn't know what's going on in Indiana, well, I'm sure you do now. Indiana got its fair share, and isn't it funny that the vice president of the U.S. could possibly be the same guy from Indiana? It's crazy. So we needed to get together because we need to crowdsource money, and we didn't want to put names of who was giving the money in the lawsuit. We just wanted to give it a coalition name. So Rob and I reached out to as many people as we could. Rob, being in California, was able to reach out to more people than myself. But at the end of the day, we started the coalition, and this coalition has been fighting since last June. We are also the third person technically to hand in our lawsuit in Washington, D.C. against the FDA. So you had You had Nicopure with Halo, which was quick to get theirs in. I think they were 3 days?
No, day one.
Day one, oh, I'm sorry.
First day.
So it was Lost Art that I think was 5 days, 3 to 5 days. And then we came in. Now, there's pros and cons to doing it early because you want to see what everyone else is saying, but somehow we lucked out. We were asked by the judge in DC if we could consolidate our lawsuit with Nicopure's. If you don't know what that means, that's pretty amazing because now we pretty much have two cases in front of one judge against one entity, the FDA. Correct. On July 25th, we signed off on the paperwork merging the two lawsuits, and we have technically the biggest lawsuit against the FDA that is going to be, it's going to be heard on October 19th. It is what it is. We were quick in the first month to get $300,000 plus into our accounts to fight this battle. This is being called the $1 million lawsuit for a reason. Do you think when the judge finds in favor of whoever on the 19th, there's not going to be an appeal? I mean, if we win, you know tobacco-free kids is going to be the first one. And obviously, if we lose, what, are we just going to sit there? You guys want to lose your businesses? So, we ran through money pretty fast, and that's all because we're going through quite a bit right now. I got to hit my notes up. Sorry. I know this looks unprofessional. They had paper. You offered me paper. All right. Does anyone know what an amicus brief is? Shh. All right. So an amicus brief, when you file a lawsuit the size of, in layman's terms, kind of like what we're doing with the FDA, there's organizations around the world that can write in to the judge to say why they support that side. So you have tobacco-free kids, you have Heart and Lung Association, and many, many, many other massive organizations that are writing our judge right now. Who do we have? Who's supporting us and saying, no, you know what, the vape industry is right, I mean, you should listen to them. One, did we even paint a good enough picture that anyone should be sticking up for us? We have CASA. We have Safada. We have VapeVet, Clive Bates, and a lot more accredited healthcare officials. That's who's writing on our behalf, currently. There can be more added. Right now, we're bouncing back and forth to get responses, and the last response is due like September 8th from the FDA. And then from there, it's just kind of like a holding pattern until the 19th. So obviously, I'm up here to ask for money again. It's gotta suck for you, right? Gotta join an association. We need your money here. This is the case that is going to be heard. R2BSmokeFree.org. If you haven't donated yet, and I know it's tough to ask, but we need your support so bad right now. But we also need you to be a part of a state chapter. We need you to be a part of an association. I know it's tough. We're always asking for money, right? And I've seen so many guys, because Instagram's the shit, I could see that you're driving a fucking Lamborghini, but you haven't given a goddamn dollar. You're sure as shit paying that girl $500 a month to post a picture of the liquid next to her boobs. That's not free. I know how that works. But you can't donate or be part of an association? These are your dues. You're in an industry that went up against big tobacco. What do you expect? We need to rally right now like never before, because it's not over. We have a date. We've been waiting for that for years. We have a date. It's October 19th. There is no extensions. A judge will probably, because you have the holidays right there, by beginning 2017, will have an answer for us. Clock's ticking. I did want to say that I'm blown away just like seeing everyone sitting down and listening right now. This has happened so infrequently, like this is beautiful because we've needed this all along. I thank you guys, Lino, Steve, Carlo, thank you so much. And for all of you, I mean, we really do have to watch ourselves at this point, don't we? We're under the under a microscope at this point that it's like, I'd almost be afraid to fart in front of the wrong guy. But I will. Yeah. Breathe easy. There's people that are working to try and change things, but we need your help too. And just as I was up here saying this, I got a text from Keith Fairman from Diamond Vapor. He kicked in a grand. Thank you, Keith Fairman. Everybody. Hey, listen, I lost my best friend in my entire life last week. I sold my Delta, my Carlos Pang Delta, for my plane ticket. How many of you have mods that are just useless? Think about that.
Thank you so much, Brian. I want to thank the entire panel for coming and for giving us this valuable content. Just as Brian had mentioned, I'm standing over here and I'm looking at the attentiveness on everybody's faces, and that's very encouraging because not only are there appeals being made to you, the business owners, to donate to the advocacy groups, but I'd like to make a final appeal as well too, to remind everybody that we made this entire event free for you guys to attend. Now in other industries, I've seen similar types of settings where the price to just to hear from industry experts is anywhere upwards of $200 to $300 per person. And so, you know, you might want to take that into consideration and say, look, you know, VPX and ECC gave me a free ticket. Let me take the money that I could have spent on a ticket and maybe donate to the Right to Be Smoke Free Coalition, your local state organization, Not Blowing Smoke, whatever it is. We do want to transition at this point to an open Q&A session. If you do have questions, I'm going to ask that you make your way to the right-hand side of the stage. There's a microphone right over there. Unfortunately, it's the house mic, so we might have some technical difficulties, but if you do have any questions, make your way right over here to this microphone, and for the next about 15 minutes or so, up until about noon, the panel will be able to ask questions. So we do hope that everybody can hear the questions as well as hear the answers. I hope you guys don't get stiff necks having to turn to that guy. Okay, yeah, gotcha.
That is true!
Yeah, there will be a power button. Let me see if you... Yeah, just click on it, tap on it.
Check.
There we go, yep. So you guys ready to take some questions and answers? All right, fantastic. First question.
Hey guys, thanks. Patrick Baker from Chop PA, facing 40%, thank you very much. But my biggest question is on the sampling. We were planning on doing $10 for a year, and then, you know, it'd be a club and they get free offers throughout the year, kind of to amortize, you know,
extend your question. First time customer comes in your shops, never vaped. You have to sell them a sample first.
I understand. I mean, that's, if they want to join a club, I'd say this is a buck to taste. I mean, but I'm just saying for our regular customers who come in regularly, is $10 a year sufficient? Do we have to go 20? What do we have to do?
So, the FDA is very good at putting a lot of gray area out there and not providing answers, which I'm sure you found so far. In my own, I am an attorney, I have dealt with FDA, but this doesn't mean this is 100% end-all answer. I personally don't think it works, because the closest they've come to allowing that was in the case law I mentioned, where it was a loyalty program where you bought 10 and got one free. Their opinion is that there has to be a sale of some sort given for each transaction. So with the loyalty program, you can say, well, they bought 10 and this is their free one.
So would it be if you have a clicker, you know, that thing that's one test?
Well, the problem is everyone's getting a different amount for that price. So it could end up being down to like a penny per sample.
They're
not going to tell you. they're just gonna, they won't tell you the answer, but they'll tell you something's wrong, but they won't tell you how to fix it. And that's been my experience. They'll come in and say, well, we don't like that you're doing that. Well, what do you want us to do? Well, this is what the law says. Okay, so they will, if they were to come in and have a problem with what you're doing and you say, what should I do? They will say, under section such and such, sampling is defined as blah, blah, blah. And they'll say, we don't believe this fits into that. So it's kind of a hide the ball situation, and all you can do is do your best to stay within the gray area they've laid out before you. So for my personal standpoint is that I don't want to be in there and have them laugh at me and say, well, you couldn't possibly have thought that was okay. So that's, to me, the standard that you have to go by. And if I were to come in and you say, well, I had someone pay $10, okay, well, how many did they sample? I don't know. That's not gonna be good enough. Or if you say, I don't know, they sampled like 263 times this year. Well, how much did they sample? Well, you know, did you keep track of it? You know, how much did that person get?
Yeah. I mean, the fact of the matter is, until a compliance officer comes in and hands out the first fine, no one's gonna know.
Yeah, and the other
That's the position we're all in.
FDA will continue to issue guidance, so, you know, it's awful and it's terrible, but when they have these webinars and things, you should submit the specific question and try to get them to respond, and maybe they will. They may surprise us and respond, but to this point, they haven't specifically addressed it, and until they do, it's a guessing game.
I know it's frustrating for everybody because everybody wants and justifiably wants a concrete answer, and as Brittany pointed out, it's just all gray all the time. There's no concrete anything other than that we're screwed a lot of the time. But if I were you, if I were in your position, I would capture it on a per transaction basis, capture the tax that goes with it, make it a full-on transaction, and err on the side of caution, meaning don't make it super comfortable for the consumer. This is a two-part answer. Don't make it super comfortable for the consumer, meaning if FDA came in, does it look like a gimme, like it doesn't pass the laugh test or whatever. But to the business side of this, now you're in an area where salesmanship and in-store marketing are vital. When you get a new customer now, you don't have free sampling anymore. That's not gonna be enough to make the sale. That's not gonna be enough to just bring them in the door. Like now is when you need salespeople who are trained, who understand, who can explain why there's value in staying and paying whatever it is to sample your products because XYZ. And that's the value proposition that each business should already have and know what it is. You know what I mean? So that's what I would do if I were you.
Does it have to be up front, you know, or do you want to charge 10 cents a text?
I was thinking it.
And I monitor my employees, and I monitor how many they make, and they taste 20 flavors, and I add $2 to their ticket. Is that okay, or do I have to charge it up front?
I think that's closer than doing your previous suggestion, and that's not to guarantee that's going to be okay, but I think you're charging what you think is a fair amount, and you know.
Okay, last question is, are we able to, if someone comes in and their 510 connector is a little funky, can we make an adjustment on it for our customer?
Again, it's a gray area. All of the FDA attorney interpretations I have seen thus far have said modifications in the shop constitute creating a new product, and then you handing it back to them is giving them a free product.
If you're modifying it.
What if I'm just, you know, it's their connectors went down a little bit, I screwed up the cards.
If you're not changing it, it's a gray area. I wouldn't do it with an inspector in the store.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Sure. I will say something else that reminded me of on sampling that you should be aware of is that sampling at events such as this is included in the sampling ban. For consumers. No, it's for everyone. Oh. Well, maybe it's a great area then. Maybe a great area.
Hey, quick, just because I got in the heat of the moment, I forgot to say some key things real quick. Just so you guys know what we're going up against with the FDA on October 19th. You know, we had a two-year window to make sure everything goes through PMTA. The FDA on record say it could take them decades, plural, to go through all that. So one of the big things that we're arguing is how unjust that is. How can you give us 2 years when they said it could take them decades? That's just a key that I just had to get out there. Sorry about that. Next question.
Well, and that's also, I think everybody here that's paying taxes and has a store also has a mailbox that can receive a letter that would allow everybody to be compliant from the government. That's the big deal right there. Our question is also on the same point again. I guess after hearing the legislation part of it, maybe I missed it. It sounds like there may be a separate part of the language for sampling. But if the packaging rule comes into effect and you are selling a liquid sample for consumption, then how is it that you're getting around the tamper-proof evident packaging if they're going to consume something because if an employee is this strong and wanted to kill somebody and put poison in that bottle before it got consumed, is how the government would be looking at that. So how can a sample be sold for 10 cents if it's not
weird.
Yeah, I mean, that goes back to it. To me, looking at it, it meets the definition of a new product every time. So you couldn't, like, give a taste to someone. You would have to actually be giving them a sample size, and that would have to be on the market by Monday, because otherwise it's a new product. And as you correctly stated, when they put out regulations on child-resistant packaging and all that sort of thing, which they'll likely just adopt what CPSC is doing, but it's a new product.
So if that were the case and you were going to make these samples by Monday, that would also mean that you would have to be getting your caps from the certified cap
right.
provider.
Right. And that would be under the current CPSC law. The sample has to actually be a product. Yeah.
And so, to follow up on what Brittany said, since probably you don't have a lot of time to run back to your shops and or your businesses and make little itty bitty baby sample sizes, just designate whatever the smallest size in the store is as the sample size and use that. There's a lot of margin in liquid. There's a lot of margin, you know, designating the smallest size as the sample one is not going to kill anybody here. So, and that's one way around it without you having to introduce a whole, you know, a brand new size for every flavor that you've got.
And I guess I will just add one extra question for clarification. Is it okay if the bottle is open on a display shelf to show your bottle just so long? That's okay. Is that correct here or not correct?
You
should
sell it.
If all the samples compliant, we have the GCC.
It's just on the counter. You're not selling it. An open bottle.
An open bottle, somebody can see it. It has this Costco on it. You know, they cannot consume it.
Yeah, that's, yeah, that's fine.
Good morning. My name is Wendy Wright from Lake Anonymous. Breakfast Friday. I have a question and a couple of comments. I've been vaping over 10 years. I'm a cancer survivor, 16 years. I recently had a triple bypass. My doctor said go for it as far as vaping goes. So I've been bouncing between analog and digital for a few years, but kind of stuck on digital. The question I have is the ramification
district congressional group up in the House. I have invited him out to play camp and to talk to all the local businesses when they show up. I'm trying to get him in for a town hall and meet the public. So I want to put that out. We haven't seen it on Facebook yet. It's out there. I know Mom and Pops is here. It's local. It's a short talk from the local businesses. I would encourage you, when you see that pop up,
all right, so let's talk about this. So, it's just like kind of the position we're in right now. No one really knows. And that's the worst answer to get, because all of us, we want answers. Best case scenario, we change the grandfather date. We get PMTA accepted. We're also fighting for the amount that they're charging. The cost, I'm sorry, be politically correct. That's, our key concerns are making this something where the average Joe that opened a store here isn't gonna go out of business. We kinda wanna make this an even playing field for everybody. But let's be honest, doors will close. Lots of doors will close in the meantime. If we lose, we fight again. I mean, they're calling this the $1 million lawsuit because, I mean, we're almost to court and at 300 spent. And by the way, through Dimitri, I just got to say his name, and getting Sevio on board with us. Sevio put a lot of that up. So there are some amazing companies that want to see this go through, but when these appeals happen, because we're not going to stop fighting, I mean, we just got to be ready to go again. So I don't know, I can't even tell you, because I'm just interested to see what the judge says in general.
Where do we go?
r2bsmokefree.org.
Okay.
It's also where you can donate. Click the donate button. Thank you.
Hey guys, first of all, on behalf of VPX, I want to thank you guys always for being on here. My question is, on the manufacturer side, is it true that flavorings that we use, the flavor companies have to require to turn in a master file? And my follow-up to that is, since the components that we're using, which is BG, BG, and A, those companies as well have to turn a PMTA for our product to be compliant.
Well, if you're going TPB and you want to sell overseas, there's only one MIG you can use anyway.
How about for local?
So in the US, when you are submitting various submissions to the FDA, previously the ingredient listings, they did not make you go beyond your GRAS file, and now we think that they will make you go beyond that and require master files, and flavor houses are extremely reluctant to cooperate on anything to do with the FDA, and I can guarantee you they will continue to be extremely hard to work with. So one thing you should start doing now is talk to your suppliers and say, look, if you want me to continue to purchase from you, you need to agree right now that you're going to work with me on dealing with the FDA. And part of that will be that you have to work with the FDA on turning over what you see as proprietary formulas. And one way the FDA has sought to be able to work with industry on that is through master files. And the issue with that, when it comes to, luckily or unluckily, this industry currently will not have to do substantial equivalence filings, but how do you do a master file when you're comparing one product to another if you don't know what is in that master file for one product to another? So that's something the FDA has yet to provide an answer as to how a master file is helpful in that circumstance if the flavor profile is something that's been altered in some way. But the FDA will ask in your application proprietary formulas in one way or another, either through a non-disclosure agreement or through master files from your suppliers. And you should start having those conversations now.
And that includes the PG, VG, and the nicotine?
Yes.
And there's a little bit I want to add to this. If your flavor manufacturers are not already on your side and willing to help you, you have time to reformulate everything. 2 days. And keep in mind, if you reformulate after Monday, it's a new product.
Hey guys, I got a quick question. It might not be relevant to everyone, but I have a juice manufacturer who white labels my house line for me. And as a store owner, is there anything that I have to be doing differently? Does that make me a manufacturer because they're making my name on it? Or, I mean, their bottles are
so there's always been a question with how to handle if the brand is your brand and you own the trademark, but you're not actually manufacturing it. The FDA has not taken a stance thus far other than to say where the manufacturing takes place is the address you have to register. But you as a company marketing and owning the product, you're the registered party with the agency. Does that make sense? Or they've allowed you to do it that way so that you control your brand.
He bears the burden of
right. So you would be the one in control of that unless you have an agreement with your supplier that they're going to handle the regulatory side, but you're just registering the product. But what that does is that allows you to control your own product. However, if you don't register it as your own product, your supplier could say, screw you, I'm going to go down the street and sell your product to someone else instead.
Yeah, so, I don't have any regulations other than my purchase.
Right, so you would want to work out with them, I'm going to register this as my product, but our agreement is that you bear the cost and the regulatory side of this, and maybe you contribute to it or they raise your price in some way to cover it. No, because they are still consuming product without paying.
I would give them target.
We'd be given another
paying. Yes.
Yeah, target.
Yeah,
I would use the river.
Right. Yeah.
Okay.
But that goes back to the issue we were talking about before is if they're just, you know, using the dripper and using a random bottle, you're creating a new product every time they do that, which you won't be able to do past Monday.
So in other words, like if we have 30 little bottles that people are dripping, they have to just have another bottle every time.
Yeah. That would be the way I read it, because of the whole new product aspect of it.
And is it true you're not allowed to set up a new purchase for someone's device? If they go on a timer, they box, show them how to fill it.
Battery and tanks.
No, you're creating a product. Yeah, you would be creating a product then.
Okay, and then can we use our own setup to demonstrate it, our own personal?
My interpretation is you can demonstrate, but you cannot create a new product for them beyond Monday.
Okay, thank you.
Uh-huh. No. What I was saying is you can't just have a bottle sitting on the counter open that you're just continuously using as a sample that someone's paying for. So you're having to, they're having to purchase a product from you, and that product can't alter. So.
Like same tank, like.
Right.
We offer, like we're gonna offer you samples on this battery in this tank with this juice. That's what we can do. If we're doing it on like separate drippers and different.
Well, the key is that
we're building it.
The key is you're making a transaction on that product you're sampling. So that is a product that they're buying. So once you modify that product in some, so let's say they bought 1 ml as their sample and you give them 1 ml, that's one product, and that one product has to meet all of these standards that the FDA happens to put out on that one product. So for example, if they're requiring, you know, tamper-evident packaging, you couldn't meet that with that one ml sample.
They mean like, what's your question? Someone comes in and, you know,
test
your
setup. Uh-huh. Right.
That's what they mean. As long as it's the same continuous setup, yeah, it's fine. It's the same tank.
You can change the coil,
same coil, same product. You're making, recreating the same product, but you're not going to be like rebuilding drippers for them to use, because then you should be giving them a different variation.
Excuse me, would you see the microphones?
Yeah. So your question was, can you not use a tank to sample? Of course you can use a tank to sample. That's the only thing you can use to sample. That's it. What Brittany was saying is that there's certain parameters required for the sampling, but of course you can use a tank, right? And if your tank breaks, just replace it with the same tank or a tank, it's fine. But yes, you're fine.
Don't change your tasting stations. Keep them the same. Okay, so if you're using drippers and whatnot, get rid of them, put a sub tank on, call your employees now, whatever you want to use, use it. You can't use a different variation if you don't have documentation that you've been using it and selling it as a sample before Monday. Does that make sense? No? No, I want to make sure you understand. Oh no, I know. That doesn't mean any advice we're giving, it doesn't mean that we agree with it. It doesn't mean that like we're supporting it. It's just, we're just relaying the facts. We have to comply. We all have to comply. Don't be cute. I mean, just follow the law, because if one person starts getting in trouble, they're gonna start looking at everyone even more and more and more. It's gonna keep happening. My husband has owned smoke shops for years, and when the convenience store down the street was selling spice, they would come in and raid our shops looking for it. So if the vape shop down the road is doing all this crazy stuff, they're gonna come in and get in your shop too. And they leave a mess, they don't clean it up, they take your stuff. It's, just don't be cute. Just, because it affects us all. And don't go calling, I know someone said that we're like the vape police. Don't be turning each other in either. That's not a marketing strategy, because that will come back and bite you. Do not do it. It's not marketing. It will not save your business, it will harm your business. Instead, call that other business owner and say, hey, look, this is the law, please follow it. You know, we don't want to get in trouble. Or refer them to someone that, you know, they might have a better relationship with, or just have them PM Stefan in the middle of the night. He'll answer. Like, someone will answer. Just, we have to work together. If we don't work together right now, we're all gonna fall apart. So, that's my tangent.
Nope, she's got a question.
I actually have a couple of questions. We have 30 mil, 60 mil bottles in our store, also 120 mils. And we already have bottles that are open that we use for sampling. For the 30 mils and the 60 mils that are already, you know, they have the chocolate caps and they're already, you know, they have the plastic on them. Are we allowed at some point when we sell out of a certain flavor, if we have the Destro bottle that has just a little bit gone out of it, are we allowed to sell that or no?
No.
Not at all. Okay. So
I'd say that just out of like, I wouldn't.
And I have another question. We're also on Facebook. Our shop has a page on Facebook, and we are constantly getting questions about, you know, our big items, you know, and products that we have and certain things. Do we have to have a third party ID these people if they are not part of our customer base? Or how does that work? Like, is there legislation or rules? Is there anything about it? Because locally, we have, you know,
For Facebook?
For Facebook. Communications about vape products.
Are you selling them products?
No. They were just
then no.
About this. No. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, there aren't currently advertising restrictions with regard to Facebook, with regard to vapor products.
Do you guys know any of the third parties or online verification, age verification?
I have somebody. If you see me after the thing, I'll text you the info.
Okay.
Give me the. It's
the opportunity.
Yeah.
Yes.
I have the website address in my phone. I'll go get it and come back and read it out.
Yeah, that actually came really good. I would like to get that information as well. But my question is to get clarification on August 8th with devices and tanks needing to be in one package together. And if it is in a package together, is that a scenario that you're able to assemble it? And if it's where you sold a device and then sold a tank, you would not be able to help the customer assemble it. Is that what I'm understanding?
Don't assemble anything
for them. Even if it's all in one box?
No, because you're creating a new product then.
Okay, even if it's all packaged together as one little device.
But you're further manufacturing it from that point, so.
Hold on. What if the product's already sold, the transaction's done, it's their property now? Mm-hmm. You're basically selling their property.
But you're then modifying it and then giving it away.
Keep your hands
up. So you hit twice.
Yeah. That would be the conservative interpretation of it.
All right.
I'm sorry, Steve?
Yes.
The age verification is agechecker.net. Agechecker.net.
And he's a really cool guy.
He is a very cool guy.
How you doing? My name is Jojo. I have a vape shop in Ohio. About 2 years ago, I went to strictly house juice, where I buy by the gallon and I bottle my own juices. Everything I've heard here pretty much says I'm kind of screwed, let's just put it that way. But how do I determine all the flavors? I've mixed probably a couple thousand, 2,000, 3,000 flavors because people come in and say, put this and this together. How do I publish that by one day? I mean, I have like 400 solid flavors that are, you know, base flavors or whatever. How do I put that out there to prove that these are juices that existed, a flavor existed before this day?
Regardless of it being manufactured before August 8th, I mean, you would have to go through the PMTA process for all 400 of them, times whatever nicotine levels, times whichever ml bottles choices. I mean, you're looking to the $1 billion for 400.
How do I operate on Monday?
You're gonna have to make a decision about what you're gonna make. You can't mix on the fly anymore. So you can't custom mix anymore. When a customer says, give me a little bit of this, a little bit of that, that's done. So you have to, whatever your stock items are, that's what you have for Monday. Whatever's already set and doesn't require you making a new thing. If it's not recorded somewhere, if you don't have it on your dated inventory list, you can't do it.
Okay. Well, thanks for coming by your short society.
But the reality is everyone here is going to go through the same thing. How many of these guys here are manufacturing e-liquid, just decided to take it down a notch, lose flavors, lose Nick, and go with one standard bottle or two? I mean, it's everyone's, we've been feeling it for a while, man. I'm sorry. Absolutely not. No.
Don't use drippers.
I gotta tell you, again, another reality. I'm formerly a vapor shark. In our stores, there's 220 Kanger tanks on the wall, filled. It sucks.
I mean, the only way you're going to get by this is by having the same tank at all times with e-liquid already in them.
Okay, so I have to get tanks for every juice that's on my bowl.
Yes.
But I can still... All right, that's it. I think that answers it.
The dripping thing doesn't work with the regulations. Yeah. It just doesn't work.
In my pocket, it works.
Yeah. Yeah, it sucks.
R2BSmokeFree.org. Good luck. We're fighting the free on the 19th.
Good luck, bro. So, my name's Heidi. I'm from the Coffee Table Manager of Rockland County, New Jersey. And we're already a part of the association, Brian, I'm here for Coffee Table. I have a couple of questions. One, do we have to have ID verification system in the store or only online?
Your employees are the ID verification system in
okay.
the store.
Now, there's a mix-up, too, because I keep hearing the age 27, but if you've been watching the seminars and that well-spoken droning of a man in that suit said 35. He said 35 in the very first seminar. I mean, your employees, if they just miss one person, I wouldn't even write them up, I would fire them. It's, your livelihood at this point is at stake. If a compliance officer comes in without making mention of who he is, and your employee knows a guy that comes in all the time, and he's ID'd him a million times, but that one day he doesn't ID him, that could be your first fine.
Yes.
Every time. You never know when a compliance officer is going to be in there. How many people on Toss It Tuesday had a compliance officer come in to check your bottles, your caps, your GCCs? Two vapor sharks were hit that day. They're out there, and they're going to start coming in swarms. The way I understand it, you're not going to put anything through PMTA. I mean, PMTA is crazy, especially if you're a shop owner, because you literally have an endless amount of things that you can create in there. The registering as a manufacturer is free. Is there any harm in it?
Clarify what what the demonstrator is. Yeah, that'll work. By the way, instead of, I mean, streamline, just videotape somebody doing that and play the video all day. Yeah, just put it on loop and just play it all day. I thought about that yesterday and I was like, nobody rip off my ID, I'm gonna do it. And then somebody last night was like, hey, I made a video. Yeah.
Actually, yesterday somebody asked me, why can't we just like, run YouTube videos by Nick Green and all these folks showing how to build, and I'm like, you do not want to do that, because guess what? A lot of the time, they're talking while they're building, yappity yap, cessation claim, quit smoking, but you do not want to have that in your store, so be careful with using other people's material.
I don't know if this was on the docket when you were reading the amicus brief, but we just got new amicus briefs. From third-party groups, Tech Freedom and National Center for Public Policy. So it's always good to have non-industry weigh in the court case on our side. So that's good news. Just a press release.
Hi, you. Sorry, loud voice. Are there any testing facilities, third-party testing facilities, or additional testing requirements the
I'm not sure I followed the question. Can you ask again?
I'm sorry. I'm a hardware manufacturer.
Yeah.
For the mods we make, there are listings of certain safety requirements that the mod must have. Who's going to test that? Is there a third-party facility? Is the FDA going to test it? Or is it left in the gray area?
Where did you get that?
There aren't currently product standards issued by the FDA.
There are?
No.
Like
an AIMSA type standard or like,
yeah.
There are no current FDA mandated product standards, and they have to go through a notice and comment. So similar to what they did with the deeming regulation, they have to put it out on the regulations.gov website, industry and other interested parties review it. You submit comments, usually 60 to 90 days. The FDA takes it back, reviews those comments, and then they'll issue final product standards.
The next question I have is, there are some different chips that we use. I know the FDA came out and said you must give your master file while you're coding the chips. What if the manufacturer of those chips, because we manufacture chips and it's one of the different containers, what if those manufacturers don't provide those to the FDA? Are we just SOL?
Yes.
They,
so the product that is regulated that you have to file applications on is the product that is being sold to the end consumer.
Right.
So the chip would be a part of the device, correct? You're not selling the chip to the consumer. So the chip would be a component of the overall application. Well, only the components being sold to the end consumer have their own individual applications. So where that component gets broken down is when the end product, that application, each ingredient or component or part of that gets broken down all the way back. And that's where you need that information.
Right, that has to go all the way back to the manufacturer.
Right. But yeah, it's still the issue that your supplier has to cooperate with you. Well, your supplier needs to understand that if they want to continue selling into this industry, they're going to have to deal with the FDA. Otherwise, you should get a new supplier pretty quickly.
I do know that Evolve is putting their chips through the FDA.
I know. That's...
All right, at this point, we're going to transition to our B2B portion of the Vape Exhibit. The exhibit hall is going to be open until 7 p.m. But I personally, on behalf of ECC and VPX, want to thank all of the attendees that have been here. You guys have been amazing. We've been saying this since 2012, that in order for us to survive, everybody's got to come together. And what I'm seeing out here is everybody coming together, financially pooling resources together, sharing information. It's mind-boggling to me to see that this 4 years of work that we've been putting into this industry is starting to manifest itself because of the regulations that I want to thank our panel, our speakers. By a show of hands, how many people had something positive to take away in terms of information from this?
Yeah.
That is awesome. That is awesome.
Spread it!
So I want to thank them.
Spread it!
I've been getting approached here backstage by several people asking about where, you know, there's five or six different sources here. Where do I spend my money? I've got X amount of dollars. Should I split it up or give it to one guy or the other? So by a show of hands, how many people are interested in making a financial donation to the advocacy group today?